welcome Donovan as he tells us about how to use our brains.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Toastmaster. Have you ever wanted to grab someone by the shirt and yell, "Think! Use your freaking brain!" Well, I know I, for one, have felt that way before, and thank goodness I did not act on that impulse. But the important thing that I've taken away from these encounters is that, really, some people don't think, or not beyond a certain depth. And even more importantly, they don't realize that they're failing to continue their thought and see where it leads them. So they'll live their life, and until an event or another person, some confrontation comes up and smacks them in the face, only then will they sit down and reflect on the contents of their mind. I would say that this kind of person lacks a meta-awareness, that is, an awareness of their awareness. Someone who does have a meta-awareness is somebody who knows what they believe, but then also asks themselves, why do I believe this? And also, are my reasons good enough? Can I play devil's advocate and try to tear down my own ideas? Or are they built on a solid foundation and structure of reason? The mere fact that it is possible for people to go through their lives and live in this way means that it's also possible for you and I to have ideas that we haven't fleshed out ourselves. Maybe not in everything, maybe only in a few things here and there. We hold some idea and we just have it, we just think it, and we don't dig any deeper. I like to compare the idea of carrying around a bad idea with walking around and having a piece of spinach stuck in your teeth. Right? It's an uncomfortable thing, and you hope to goodness that that never happens to you. But how can you avoid being like somebody who's walking around with a piece of spinach in your teeth? You'll never know unless you do one of two things. First would be to stop and take a look in the mirror and see that it's there for yourself. And that is like doing some very serious self-reflection and thinking about some of the ideas that you hold. The second thing you can do is make sure that you surround yourself with people that will tell you if you have a piece of spinach stuck in your teeth. You don't want people that are too polite, and you want people basically that will look you in the teeth, will look you in the brain, and look at the contents and say, "No, I don't agree with you, but let's sit down and talk about it and figure out if I'm crazy or if you're crazy." Because neither of us want to walk out of this room with somebody having a piece of spinach stuck in their teeth. So, what can you do to cultivate this kinds of meta-awareness within yourself, the things that you can do personally? Because you can't, it ultimately comes down to you. If your friend tells you some idea, you can't just take it on faith. You still have to consider their idea and weigh it and see if it fits with everything else that you think. And the best way that I can think of for making sure that you're not picking up or carrying around bad ideas is to integrate your ideas. Now, what does that mean? When I talk about integrating ideas, I mean that you make sure they fit together. If you hear a new idea or some politician comes up with some plan for solving some problem and you think, "Gee whiz, that sounds wonderful," take it and see how it fits in with all of your other, you know, values, your other, the rest of your worldview, how you see those different forces and those different issues on that particular policy. I think it'll be really helpful if we look at an example. I'm going to use the example of an extreme leftist and how they would realize some contradictions if they practiced integration. So, an extreme leftist, on one hand, if there's somebody who fervently believes in climate change, they will tell you that there is nothing that we can do proactively to reverse it. They will say that the climate is such a complex system that we can't do things like emit sulfur dioxide or seed clouds that would counteract carbon dioxide and actually cool the planet. They say that because it's so complex, all that we can do is pull back and remove ourselves as much as we can from the system and let it work itself out. But on the other hand, they'll tell you that the economy, yes, it's a complex system, but we have these geniuses in the Federal Reserve and in the Treasury Department, and they can figure it out for some reason. And so they say the climate is a complex system and the economy is a complex system. But we can control one and we can't control the other. And they don't see that that's a contradiction. That is a contradiction. Why, when one system is so complex that it cannot be controlled, would an equally complex system be uncontrollable? And they need to come up with a fundamental reason that explains the difference between the two to support a point like that. And for me personally, I have to do the same thing because I hold just the opposite view. Personally, I think we can proactively manipulate and fine-tune the climate, whereas we can't do that with the economy. And that's a contradiction for me unless I figure out a fundamental reason that makes them different. In this case, it's that in an economy, the building blocks are human beings with free will. You can try to control what people will do, but if they catch on to what you're doing, they can behave rationally, or they can behave irrationally, they can go along with what you're doing, or they can choose to spite you and not do it. The climate is made up of molecules of nitrogen and oxygen and dust particles. And if you create a high pressure zone over here and a low pressure zone over here, you can't have a molecule of nitrogen say, I know I'm supposed to go over there. However, I'm onto you and I know what you're doing. I'm going to go that way. It can't do it. So that's why, for me, that's not actually a contradiction, because I've integrated what appeared to me initially to be a contradiction and said, well, how can I make sense of this? How can I resolve this? So that's a comfortable example, because I think everybody in this room, for the most part, you know, isn't terrified of climate change and doesn't think we should be screwing around with the economy. But that's essentially what we just did, essentially, was look at the spinach in somebody else's teeth. But in order for us to really do that kind of self-reflection for ourselves, we have to have the will and the courage to try and integrate our ideas together, even if it makes us uncomfortable. When you are thinking about the economy, climate change, God, the purpose of your life, make sure that the reasons, the basis for why you think it's okay to believe this on, you know, with this amount of evidence in this case, and why it's okay to not believe this because there's insufficient evidence in this particular case, or whether it's a matter of evidence, or whether it's a matter of faith, and whether somebody who believes in climate change not on scientific data, but because of a spiritual revelation from their pastor, is that grounds for belief in climate change? You know, what you use to get your knowledge, it should all be consistent, right, across your different fields. And if it's not, you need to have a darn good reason why it isn't. So look yourself in the mirror. Look deep into your teeth and your mind and make sure that it's all fitting together. Thank you.